Today I'm joining Jamie Reid, Copeland's outgoing MP, to talk about his 12 years in politics and the future of Copeland. Thank you very much for having me here today, Jamie.
My pleasure.
Thank you for letting us sit down today and talk to you. So I would like to take it right back to the beginning and talk about you, really. So you were born and bred in Copeland. Can you tell us a little bit about how your growing up affected you going into politics, and when did it first interest you?
I think I'd always been interested in current affairs. I'd always had a passion for what was going on in the news. And I'd come from a quite political family as well. So I was very close to my grandparents, both of whom had been involved in the Labour Party and the trade union movement for, I think, pretty much all their lives. But my parents were the rock and roll generation, and it completely passed them by. And I think it's a feature of political families that political children, if you like, or the children of politicians, they give politics a miss. They see what it takes out of you. They see what you have to give to it. And it is fairly common that it's the grandchildren or the great-grandchildren that kind of pick up the baton again, if you like. But I can remember, apart from the fascination just for news and current affairs and what was going on in the world, and having two grandparents who would sit and discuss these things with me, I'd go to my grandparents on a weekend, usually on a Saturday, at Kells in Whitehaven, and look out over Hague Pit. And my grandmother, who was a former mayor, she wanted to be a teacher when she was growing up. And the house looked out onto Hague Pit, where her father, along with hundreds of others, where his body remained after a mining disaster. And I always remember her telling me that, I think she was 4 years old when it happened, and she was scrubbing the step, which is what happened, which is what how people lived their lives and everything else. And when she lost her father, her dreams of being a teacher went with him. She didn't know this until much later. But so at a young age, I learned organically. Nobody sat me down in a political context and said, this is how things work, but learned organically about our community, the lives of people that built our community, their experiences and their histories, and what it meant for their opportunities in life. And so I was always very acutely aware of those things. And they inspired me in a big way to want to go into politics later on in life. It's certainly not a decision I made when I was very young.
But can you recall the moment that you made that decision that you wanted to join the Labour Party specifically? When was it that you went, Labour's for me?
That had been something which had been in me ever since I was interested in current affairs. I wanted to be on the side of the marginalised, the disempowered, the dispossessed, the people who weren't getting their fair stake in society or in life. That was always my impulse. And I was 16 when I joined the Labour Party. But I think I was Labour before I joined. I think there's, whatever your political views, I think there are millions of people who firmly and strongly affiliate with a political party without being a member of it, or identify rather than affiliate with a political party. And I'm certainly one of those with regard to Labour.
So, you remember when you joined the Labour Party when you were 16. When did you decide you wanted to go into politics? When was that moment for you?
That was an evolving process, really. So I can remember. I can remember the first job I wanted was to be the captain of Liverpool. That's what I wanted to be. And up until a few years ago, I think I'd have still got a game. But I went to study. I think I became really, really politicised, if you like, and more politically conscious and really politically active under the government of Margaret Thatcher. That's when I got really politically motivated. And I went to, she stopped being Prime Minister just before I left school. And when I went to university, I was the first of my family to go to university, and I went to study English because I wanted to be a journalist and I wanted to write about politics and current affairs, so I wanted to do. And whilst I was at university, I kind of evolved in my thinking, and I now know that this is not a correct analysis or understanding of how the media works. I didn't at the time, but I do know now. And the decision that I made was, I'd rather be influencing the events that people write about than simply writing about those events. of course, the act of writing about the events probably influences politics more than anything else right now. And I think with social media and everything else, that's even more true. But it was when I was at university, I decided I don't want to be a journalist anymore. And I initially thought I'll be a lawyer. I'll try and do social good, social justice work from within the law. I went to law school for about a fortnight, realised it was not for me. Came out, and then it was, I think I was doing a part-time job as a computer programmer at Cockermouth, and on the Strawberry Howe Industrial Estate, and on that estate was where Tony Cunningham, who was the Member of the European Parliament at the time, had his office. And I went and knocked on his door and said, is there any possibility of perhaps being a researcher for a while in your office? And he said, yeah, would you like to come to Brussels? It was as simple as that, and I owe Tony a huge amount for everything that I've been able to do in politics since that point. So I was around about 21 when I realised that I wanted to have a proper career in politics.
You became MP then in 2005, am I right?
Yeah.
Can you recall when you decided you wanted to run for MP? Because that must have been a major decision.
Well, I was a huge supporter of Jack Cunningham, my predecessor. He's a great man and a really good friend, and did a huge amount for our area, in my opinion. And that thought process began once there was a vacancy. And there wasn't a vacancy until January 2005. But prior to expressing an interest in becoming a Member of Parliament for Copeland, I was already a Copeland Borough Councillor. And I hadn't been a Copeland Borough Councillor for very long, a couple of years at most. And I freely confessed to not doing that job very well and not enjoying that job particularly. I think it needs a particular set of attributes to be a councillor, which are in many ways very, very different to what it takes to be an MP. But so I was already in public life. I was already representing the Labour Party in public office. But I think more importantly than that was when the vacancy arose, I'd recently become a father. And what propelled me more than anything else was wanting to make sure that the health service, schools, employment, everything that we want to see in our area was better for my children than it was for me. So it was that impulse which drove me then, which drives me now. And which in many ways has driven my decision to leave Parliament as well.
But Copeland was always named a safe seat for Labour. It was named up until, I'd say, recently, when people are trying to sort of take the seat in the coming by-election. Even though it was named a safe seat, how did it feel to win that election and be named MP?
I mean, first of all, I don't think it's ever been a safe seat. I think there's been a lot of talk about this which has never been true and never been substantiated by the figures on the page, actually. But it's always been a contestable seat. It's always been hard fought and hard won, and I think that if anyone was to ever take this constituency for granted, then they'd be in for a rude awakening. So I think I think that's true, but to be... So I had opportunities before become the MP for Copeland. I had opportunities to stand in other seats, which were genuinely safe Labour seats, where you kind of, weigh the vote. I have to say, I don't think there's any safe seats for any party in the country anymore, by the way. I think that's probably a good thing, but going back 12 years and even further, there was the opportunity to go for, and I was encouraged to go for other seats where it would be, where they'd been considered much more safe. But I wasn't interested. I wanted to be the Member of Parliament for Copeland. I wanted to be the Member of Parliament for my home area, for the people that I grew up with and everything else. And to put something, to try and repay the community that had given me so much. And so when I became Member of Parliament for the area, I was elated. I was over the moon. It's a feeling that will never, ever leave me. One of the proudest moments of my life. I think I got the biggest swing to the Labour Party of any candidate in the country at that election, which is difficult when you consider that that was the third term for Labour government. So I was really honoured, flattered, humbled, and always will be by the confidence and the faith and the trust that people place in you.
Was it the same for the 2010 and then again for 2015 to win it again? Did it feel still elating? Or?
It's always elating. It's always to put yourself out there as a potential representative and to lay out a series of ideas and objectives and ambitions and for people to say, yeah, that's what we want and we agree with that, is fantastic. I think maybe even 2010 was better than 2005 because there was a huge boundary change in the middle. So the election in 2005 didn't have Keswick and surrounding towns and villages in the Copeland constituency, but the election 2010 did, and it was widely predicted that, you know, I wouldn't retain the seat, and I retained it with a pretty healthy majority. So that was really gratifying because you're reaching out to a whole new group of people when you get the constituency enlarged, and you're selling again a series of ambitions and a prospectus for the future, and that was really gratifying. I think that was maybe particularly gratifying as well in 2010, because I think the last 2 weeks of that general election campaign I spent in the hospital bed. So that was very rewarding, but 2015 no less so.
12 years since 2005, now you're leaving. In those 12 years, what could you name some of your proudest moments?
Absolutely. So I've always campaigned on three specific objectives, and they are around the nuclear industry and what that means for our economy, the health service and education. And I've just come back, literally yesterday, got back in from Atlanta in the States, looking at the new nuclear reactors which they're building there, which are the same type that we're going to be building at Moorside. £20 billion worth of investment, thousands of jobs, going to be genuinely and truly transformational for the area, economically, I think culturally too. I think it's going to make us one of the fastest growing parts of the UK economy. That's what I set out to do. So I'm just delighted that we're on that road now and can't wait to see that work come to fruition. The new hospital at the West Coleman Hospital is something I'm incredibly proud of. Spent so much time, effort, blood, sweat and tears on that hospital. It's a hospital which my four children were born at. It saved my life twice during my time doing this job. But there's still a lot of work to be done there, and the fight for services, I think, is the issue which is going to define this by-election campaign. And then in education, which is something I'm incredibly passionate about, if you look at Westlake's Academy, then we took two struggling schools. We made a difficult choice to go for the academy concept at that time, to create an entirely new body. And we've now got one of the best schools in the county, and it's on its way to become one of the best schools in the country. I was there last week presenting prefects with their ties, and it just gives me a huge sense of optimism that we're creating such fantastic people. And more to the point, we've always been creating those people in this community, but giving them the opportunity now to kind of flex their muscles, spread their wings and show what they're capable of doing. Alongside that, we've got the Whitehaven campus, which is about to begin construction this year. Again, that's going to be transformational for our part of the world. So in terms of the nuclear industry, in terms of the health service, in terms of, I haven't even mentioned the Clitamore Health Centre, or 30,000 new dentistry places, or the fight to save community hospitals in Milham and Keswick and elsewhere, which have always been successful. I've, by and large, delivered on the promises that I made when I was first elected. And I've also thought that that's really, really important because, A, I think that's important for this area. B, I think it's really important that you do what you say, and if you can't do what you said you were going to do, at least explain why, and I think that's legitimate. But, you know, as importantly as those two things, our politics really is in trouble at the moment, and I think a lot of that trouble is driven by the belief, not necessarily a fact, but it's a belief, that politicians say one thing and do another. When I've done what I said I would do, and I think that's important for politics as well. And so whatever else people might think of me, and there'll be a range of views, that's inevitable. Nobody can say that I didn't do what I said I would do.
So, on the flip side of that, do you have any regrets as MP?
I do have regrets. I think it would be impossible to do a job for this amount of time and not have any regrets. The biggest regret and my lowest moment in politics, without a shadow of a doubt, was a personal regret as well, and I think something which, you know, I'm sure the community regret, and that was this Cumberland shootings, and that was an extraordinary thing for us all to go through, particularly for the families of those people affected. And there's very few days actually go by when I don't think about that. I don't think about how it affected people. And the response of the community and the way that the community demonstrated its character and its soul in a way after that event was absolutely phenomenal, just really, really humbling, really. So out of the very, very worst episode that could have affected our community, also came something which was truly remarkable. But aligned to that, and this is deeply personal, but I've said it before and I'll say it again, I'd literally just got out of the West Cumberland Hospital at that time, and it saved my life. And I invited David Cameron as the new Prime Minister up to the hospital, because the new hospital that we'd secured the money for had been cancelled. It'd been one of the first things that we did. It cancelled that project. And so I wanted the Prime Minister to come and see the importance of the project and what it meant to us, and to see what the hospital had done in that time of crisis as well. And I think it was that visit which was, and the lobby that was made there, which was fundamental in getting the hospital building project reinstated. But the biggest regret from that was being with the Prime Minister as he spoke to a lady in a bed with a gunshot wound, and promising her that there'd be no changes and no cuts to the services at the hospital. And that's something that will never leave me, because the opposite is true. And I think in politics, it's not just about your beliefs, it's not just about your party, it's not just about the news cycle. It really is about your character, and it really is about honour and accountability. And so that was subsequently, it transpires, that was a low point as well. I think another low point would be, I just talked there about my passion for education and how important the schools are for the future of our area, and they really are fundamentally critical to our success. The other low point would be when what was then Whitehaven School turned down the opportunity to become a brand new built academy school, and I think the issues that we see playing out in front of us now wouldn't be there if that opportunity had been taken. I could then talk, there's a series of other more light-hearted regrets, nearly missing the Queen's visit to Whitehaven was something which took years off my life, I think. And very quickly, we were on a three-line whip, so we had to stay and vote. The Queen was coming to Whitehaven, I forget what the event was, but as the Member of Parliament for the area, I had to host her, welcome her. I was on the sleeper train out of Euston, checked the times, went to get the train, got to the train station, the train had gone. Couldn't get a flight, obviously, couldn't hire a car, everywhere was closed. Long story short, had to get a cab, from Euston to Carlisle and then pick up my car at Carlisle and drive to Whitehaven. And I can tell you that it costs £847 to get a taxi from from Euston to Carlisle. But that Network Rail accepted it was their fault and they paid the fare. So.
That's okay, Ben. just
847. Just
847. Just one of those figures.
Just one of those figures, you know.
Yeah.
Figure that'll never leave me.
Stay with you forever. So we're speaking about regrets. You've spoken about how you know Jeremy Corbyn on a personal level, and you do like him and such, but do you have any regrets about your opposition to him, especially in 2015 when you resigned as Shadow Health Minister?
No, I don't. I don't have any regrets about that. I mean, I think it's important to be true to who you are. And I think if you're in politics and you don't stand up for what you believe in, then you shouldn't be in there. You should be doing something else. And you're right to say that Jeremy and I have got a really good, cordial relationship on a personal level. We have, and on a policy basis. The party couldn't be more clear about its support for nuclear power, about its support for Trident, and about its support for Sellafield, and about everything else to do with the nuclear industry. And on the health service, I mean, Jeremy's in completely the right place. He's doing exactly the right thing on that. But I don't have any regrets about doing what I did. Life is short, and was it the advice of Polonius to Laertes, to thine own self be true, I think. So you have to do that.
I'm going to take a bit of a lighter turn. In your maiden speech, you declared yourself a Jedi in the debate over the racial and religious hatred bill under consideration at Parliament at that time. Nowadays on Twitter, you have got yourself in the little information as Red Leader. Are these Star Wars references, are they to inject a relatability into public, or for want of a better word, are they for a bit of fun, or is it just you're a big Star Wars fan?
It's all of that, actually. It's so I think first of all, the Twitter profile picture, or the background picture, is of the X-Wings going across Thirlmere.
Yes.
So that was a tremendous thing to shamelessly latch onto, I think. To be a Member of Parliament for a constituency featured in the Star Wars films was something too good not to advertise. It's something I'm very proud of. We're all proud of it. But the Jedi thing, go back to the maiden speech. First of all, I think I've always been a pretty brave MP, and certainly a brave thing to do in the first sentence. In the first paragraph of your first speech in Parliament to declare yourself as a Jedi, but there was a purpose to it. And the purpose was that at the census prior to the Racial and Religious Hatred Bill coming into being, I think something like 350,000 people had declared themselves as Jedis on the census. And within the scope of that bill, those people would have been given religious protection, and the Jedi religion would have been given afforded the status as an official religion, which is clearly an absurdity. So it was, the point being made was a tongue-in-cheek, ironic point about, you know, here's a failing in the bill here. And of course that was not picked up. I had to explain it at length. So going back to regrets, there you go. I don't regret saying what I said, but I perhaps regret not maybe landing it as well as I ought to have landed it in terms of helping people to understand what was going on. But as I said at the time,
need more Star Wars fans in the comments.
Well,
it seems.
But we do, you know, we absolutely do. But it was at the time of the George Lucas, the second set of George Lucas films coming out. Films which, you know, I think, talk about regrets. I regret he ever made those. They were terrible. But seeing the. And I wanted to love them so much, but seeing the every bus in London had a Jedi on the side of it, and my young son was, of course I bought him a lightsaber and everything else, a toy lightsaber, and it was for his benefit as much as anything else to kind of just be. Yeah, it's, there's no crime in being. In being light-hearted about things, and it often is, particularly in politics, a great way. Humour is a great way in which to illustrate the point. As a rhetorical device, it really is very, very good. I think not long after that speech, there was a film company in New York wanted to come and make a film about life as a Jedi MP, and lots of other things. Someone somewhere told me that George Lucas had read about this and was in despair, and he thought it was a kind of a true reflection of my views and everything else. So, and there's a strange convention in the House of Commons that in our cloakroom you have, we talk about Hogwarts, it is a cloakroom, we have a peg with your name on it, and alphabetical order, and on your coat hanger is a pink ribbon. And that ribbon is to put the scabbard for your sword, believe it or not. And they say that politics is out of touch. And the day after I went into, the day after my maiden speech, I went into the cloakroom and there was a toy lightsaber in my scabbard. So that was a pretty good touch.
So a few of them definitely did get the joke then?
Oh yeah, a lot of them got the joke. I think Boris Johnson responded to my maiden speech and or mentioned it shortly afterwards, but he clearly didn't get the joke.
He needs to brush
up
on his Star Wars, doesn't he?
Yeah, he needs to brush his
hair. So we were talking about Twitter. You're an avid tweeter. You're very active on social media. And you have been throughout your time as MP, as long as you've been on Twitter anyway. Do you think social media is quite a key point then to keep in touch with not just your constituency, but the further public?
It's hugely important. I was a reluctant joiner of Twitter. And I was talked into it by Tom Harris, Glasgow MP. And there's actually, we were the first two MPs on iTunes, and another first. And there's a, because we used to do a podcast together, and there's a podcast out there, probably on Tom's website, which which is me joining Twitter Live for the first time, which is I was a very reluctant convert. So I think it is. I think social media can be incredibly good. I think it can be absolutely appalling as well. I think you can look. There's plenty of examples where social media is distorting politics. Look at the fake news phenomenon that we're dealing with right now, and it's bad for democracy. It's bad for us all, and we're all going to be the poorer for it. But in terms of being able to reach people, in terms of being able to help people, it's actually really good as well. So I remember during the floods, social media and the ability to get the message out there about what to do and where to go and everything else, really, really important. I can think of other areas as well. If you look at the phenomenal We Need West Cumberland Hospital campaign group page on Facebook, I mean, that's fantastic in getting people together to let them understand what the threats are to the services at the hospital and more besides. So they're really, really good examples. But of course, there's plenty of times, right, it gets it badly wrong and the effect of it are really, really serious.
You said about your mum and your dad, and you spoke about them earlier.
Yeah.
Were they always very supportive of your political career? And
well, I can't believe I've just said mum for a kick-off. It's mum in my house. Incredibly supportive. I couldn't have done it without them. They've always been there for me. They've always helped me in every possible way. Me and my brothers and sisters, I just couldn't have done it without them, really. Yeah.
Family seems to be, you've said it, it's at the centre of everything for you, it's so important to you, and you've said that family is not one of the reasons that you're resigning, but you know what I mean, it's very important to you, and it's part of your reason of resignation as MP. Could you talk about that a little bit more?
Yeah, so being a Member of Parliament is an incredible privilege, there's no two ways about that. It's a tough job, but it's an incredible privilege, and that doesn't mean to say that it doesn't bring associated costs and difficulties with it. And for me, family is the most important thing. I don't know, that sounds glib and a bit of a cliche, but in a way, you know, I think that's one of the defining characteristics of us as West Cumbrians. It's our real commitment to our families and everything else. And I just missed too much for too long. four children. You know, my wife's basically brought them up by herself while I've been away for 12 years. That's always been a tension. That's always been a regret. That's always been something that I believe I've missed out on, and which is irreplaceable. And the changing natures of any family mean that at times there's a greater need for more parental involvement than there are at other times. And we're at that time now where I think my children do need a they do need me around more than I have been, and that has been a significant factor, the significant factor in the decision that I've made, because we only get one shot at this though, and as much as anybody might think I'm a good, bad, indifferent or terrible politician, the truth is that politicians are very rarely remembered, but I think parents are. And in a straight contest between what is more important to me, and that's being a dad.
So you didn't, you said that was a main factor in resigning, and but you didn't take the decision very lightly. You really thought about it, you said that in your resignation. But you feel, and you said you feel you could do more for the constituency, so it's not just your family, you feel you could do more for your constituency if you take the role of Head of Development and Community Relations for Sellafield. Could you maybe elaborate a bit more on that?
So in politics generally, there's an understanding, I think, in society as a whole, that as a Member of Parliament you've got power, and that you can pull levers in Westminster and achieve some kind of result or change on the ground in Copeland or wherever your constituency might happen to be. That's actually not true. It's never been true, and it's increasingly less true. So I think if you look at the makeup of Copeland, and you look at the big challenges heading its way with regard to the restructuring of the Sellafield site and the challenges that the site faces with the decommissioning mission, that is going to touch upon every single part of life in Copeland. It's going to touch upon the economy, it's going to touch upon health services, education, everything else. And I think I can do more in a role within that company now, which I think is an incredibly exciting role actually, to improve the borough and to improve the constituency than I could do as a backbench member of parliament in Westminster right now. So I've always been one of the, I said before that I think I'm a brave politician. And I think central to that is going to where the action is and not turning your back on where the action is. And I think that's one of the things that I'm doing in this new role. Well, I know I am doing in this new role, otherwise I wouldn't have made the decision. And so the ability to help the Sellafield site, the workforce and the community meet the transition which is coming down the road, I think is better served by me doing this new role than it would be as being a Member of Parliament at the moment. Because apart from anything else, as an MP, you get spread so thinly over so many other issues as well, when really I think the most important challenge and the most important issues facing us are the ones to do with the changing nature of the Sellafield site. That's where I want to be making a positive difference, really. And I can do that better on the inside than I can do from the outside.
What are you looking forward to most in your new job? If you've got some aspects of what you'll be doing and you're quite excited?
I'm really excited. I'm joining a fantastic bunch of people. Paul Foster is sort of the chief executive of somebody I've known very well. As a Member of Parliament for Copeland, it's something you do. You seek to form a good relationship with the Chief Executive of the economic cornerstone of your constituents and your constituency. I've got a huge, very high regard for him. A genuine, it'll be incredibly enjoyable working for Paul and with Paul. Being able to get my hands on the challenges which are coming down there, that's going to be really, really exciting too. being able to be at home at night is going to be fantastic. I mean, one of the worst parts of being in Westminster is the dislocation you feel from your family. You know, head off on a Monday morning, I take the kids to school, the kids will have got back from school by the time I've got into the office in Westminster. That's kind of the strange dynamic of it. And then at night, it's, you know, the kind of the routine and everything else I'm never around for. So being around for my family and being around for family life is something I'm looking an awful lot more forward to. And I miss our community. I miss not being here. It might sound trite, but it's true. It's I'm not a London boy. And I think we're really privileged to be able to live here, and I've missed it.
So, just looking forward to the future now, you're going to start your new job, but there is going to be a by-election, and there is going to be a new MP. And a big thing that is focusing on when we're looking at this by-election is Brexit. And I just would like to know is, how do you feel Brexit will affect Copeland?
Well, clearly we're one of the areas that voted most heavily to leave the European Union. And I've been very clear that if I was still a Member of Parliament beyond the 31st of January, that I would be voting for the triggering of Article 50 to begin the process of leaving the European Union. It's my view that's the wrong decision for the country and it's the wrong decision for Copeland. But clearly in Copeland that's a minority view. And I think it's going to affect us in lots of ways. First of all, we actually did very, very well out of the European Union. If you look at the development of Whitehaven Harbour, European money. If you look at Westlake Science Park, the businesses that are there, the universities that are there, everything else that's followed, that was begun with European money. If you look at the legislation which has improved our environment, came from the European Union. If you look at the legislation which has improved paternity pay, rights at work, so many other issues, all came from the European Union. Because traditionally British governments wouldn't do that. The Labour government would, and the Labour government did. It was the Labour government that integrated those European laws into British law. And so we've done incredibly well out of the European Union. And being a remote constituency, and being far away from Westminster and London, and people will feel this on a routine basis. It's often the case that you feel ignored, you feel marginalised, you feel disregarded. And there's a very strong case to say that actually the European Union cared more for our long-term interests, objectives and ambitions than Westminster and Whitehall ever did. And at the same time, it's not true to say that it was a popular institution, or that its work was popularly understood, or that it did itself any favours in explaining what it did and everything else. So I think I'm particularly concerned about the impact of leaving upon the NHS. If you look at the needs of the National Health Service in our country, it needs skilled immigration. There's just no two ways about that. If you look at the makeup of our current hospital trust, I think about 27% of staff are non-British. And if you look at things like how and where does the NHS buy its drugs from, then there's a very credible situation. I'm not saying it's entirely certainly going to happen, but the pointers are all in this direction from independent economic advisors. The cost of drugs and the cost of treatments are going to go up because we've left the European Union. So that is bound to have a massive effect upon what the NHS is able to afford, what it's able to provide. And that's you and me and everybody else that gets affected by that at the end of the day. So I'm a Democrat first and foremost. I would have voted to trigger the UK leaving the European Union as per the wishes of the overwhelming majority of the constituency here. But I fundamentally, I think we're going to have to work exceptionally hard as a country to secure the benefits that staying within the European Union would have provided us with. And that's not to mention either the security aspects of it, So one of the things I've been doing latterly as a Member of Parliament is I've been a member of the NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organisation, Parliamentary Assembly, which is a group of politicians from all of the NATO countries. And it's not an exaggeration to say that Russia is excited and inspired by Britain leaving the European Union. And we're seeing, whether it's with Russian submarines in our own waters, whether it's with Russian reconnaissance planes flying over our country, whether it's with the allegations relating to Russia, both in the Brexit vote and the American presidential elections, we're seeing a different and a changing security landscape internationally. And I'm intellectually certain that remaining in the European Union would have meant that the world was more secure and we were more secure as a result of that.
How do you think Brexit will affect the roles and the issues the new MP Copeland will have to deal with?
I mean, that's a great question. And
uncertain at the moment.
I've gone on record as saying that in Parliament right now, Parliament is a very frustrating place right now. One of the reasons for that frustration is because all roads lead to Brexit. So if you want to pursue a particular avenue on a particular policy area, whatever it might be, whether it's on economic development, health service, local authorities, whatever, everything is tangled up in Brexit. Everything is tangled up in Brexit. And it's going to take years to untangle. Now, that's just a fact. That's not to blame anybody that voted for Brexit, far from it. I understand a lot of the reasons that people had. It's not to blame them in any way, shape or form. But it is to level with them, and it is to be honest with them that this is uncharted territory, and that, if you like, the bread and butter issues of politics and the bread and butter issues which the next MP for Copeland will have to concentrate upon has been made an awful lot more difficult by Brexit, because we keep hearing that Brexit means Brexit, but nobody knows what Brexit means. So, you know, there will be some difficulty ahead.
What qualities do you think the new Copeland MP needs to have at this time for the area?
I think the most important thing is to not be dogmatic in your political views. I think the most important thing is to represent the community first and foremost in every single policy area. So don't approach a position with a fixed, rigid view about what you believe in. Approach whatever the situation might be, whatever the area, policy area might be, approach that with one defining question, really, which is, what is the best result I can achieve for my constituency here? That's the guiding principle, I think, for me. So I think you know, you need to have the confidence to make sure that is at the forefront of your thinking all the time. And the reason I say confidence is because you have to resist other forces from other areas saying, well, no, you should be making this your priority or that your priority, and I don't think that that's the case. You've got to be robust. You've got to be able to take the rough with the smooth. You have to never believe anything that's said about you, either good or bad, and just know what it is you want to achieve from politics. It's a genuine honour, it's a genuine privilege. It's not something, it's a privilege which I'll probably never experience again. So it's not to be taken lightly. But if you put the constituency at the heart of everything you do, that's the best thing you could possibly do. That's the advice I would give.
There was a lot of people that put their name in the hat to, say, try and be Labour or Conservative or UKIP, whatever. But there's a lot of people that put their name in that they wanted to stand for whatever political party and such. But there was a few from elsewhere. There was some that were local. There was some people that had never entered politics. But just, do you think it matters or not whether the constituency needs a local MP or not? Do you think that they need someone that is local, or does it not matter?
I think the truth is, Rachel, it's down to the constituency to decide that. Mm. But for me as an individual, I think it matters a lot. So going back to one of our earlier discussion points, when I could have been an MP for a different part of the country, I wouldn't have felt the same passion, the same commitment, the same desire, the same ambition for that area as I ever could do for Copeland. And you see members of Parliament, or sorry, you see potential members of Parliament, you see parliamentary candidates in broadly two different camps, people who come from their community and want to represent it. Then there's a different section of people who are on an endless caravan tour of the country, essentially looking for a seat that will have them. That's not to say you don't get some good people in that way, because of course you do, you manifestly do, some brilliant people I can mention. But I've never understood that motivation. I've never understood that desire to be in Parliament for any place, at any cost, just because. It doesn't make sense to me. I think being from a community, being embedded within it, understanding its heartbeat, its ambitions, its aspirations, its idiosyncrasies, it is really, really important, I think. And I think that better secures effective representation as well. So for me, I think having a local candidate is very important.
You said earlier that it was possibly never a route you'd go down again to be a politician. However, there has been many MPs, many ministers, many politicians in general that have stepped down, sort of stood away from politics, and then re-entered it, or at least put an interest in re-entering politics. Do you ever think that politics will enter your future, you'd ever enter politics in your future again, or not?
Well, I don't have a crystal ball, but I will never leave politics. I hope politics will never leave me, but I know that I'll never leave politics. I will always be a political animal. It's in my DNA. You know, a lot of the same motivations which inspired me to become a Member of Parliament, the same motivations that have inspired me to take this new challenge at Sellafield Limited now. And so never say never in terms of a return to frontline politics. But one of the most important lessons that I've learned, and when I take parties of school children from the area down to Westminster, one of the most important lessons that I've learned is that you don't have to be in politics. You don't have to be a politician to make a big political difference. Genuinely, one of the greatest joys I have is showing school pupils from our area the broom cupboard in the House of Commons where Emily Wilding Davidson hid in order to be registered on the census when she was one of the country's leading suffragettes. And the suffragettes, I'm going off on a tangent here, I appreciate it, the suffragettes changed the world. They didn't just change Britain, they changed the world. And they weren't elected to political office. They couldn't have been elected to political office, but that's the kind of spirit that I think if we want to be the kind of country that we want to be and to grow the kind of community that we want to see here, that's the kind of spirit that we need to have. You don't need to have these two initials after your name, these two letters after your name to make a difference. You don't have to be a councillor to make a difference. You can make a difference every single day of your life. We have a kind of innate power.
Have you got any other comments or messages you'd like to say before we leave and before you leave as MP?
I'd just really like to thank Egremont today for giving me this opportunity to do this today. I've turned down broadcast bids from all over the world, France, Germany, the US, Russia Today, Al Jazeera, ITN, to talk about my time as Member of Parliament and my reasons for leaving. But I think Egremont today does such a fantastic job in the community and is such a critically important part of the community now that I thought this would be the outlet which I'd much prefer to do the first and maybe even the last on-tape interview about my departure with. So I just want to thank you for everything that you do, and please keep my successor honest.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Jamie. Thank you.